Dr. Hamid has presented to the world affordable medicine at its best, and it is indeed a privilege to hear him speak today. But before that, I would like to request our director to formally introduce our esteemed chief guest, Dr. Yusuf Hamid.
Dr. Yusuf Hamid is an Indian scientist and the chairman of 80-year-old Cipla, which is a truly international and generic pharmaceutical company. After finishing his doctorate in organic chemistry under Nobel laureate Professor Todd from Cambridge, he accepted the challenge of leading the Indian drug plant Cipla. He was not content in running a mundane business for only making wealth. Creation of affordable healthcare was strongly rooted in his heart. He is best known internationally for defying large Western pharmaceutical companies in order to provide generic AIDS drugs and treatments for other ailments, primarily affecting more than 6 million patients in poor countries such as Africa, regardless of their ability to pay. In this sense, he has been considered as a modern day Robin Hood. His role in the battle for mass antiretroviral treatment in Africa is portrayed in the documentary Five in the Blood, which was produced in 2013. It was filmed yesterday twice, and a lot of you have watched the movie, and I was informed that when people left the auditorium, they had some tears in their eyes. 2 decades ago, when millions around the world lay dying from HIV/AIDS, no one imagined that the answer would come from India. The answer was Dr. Yusuf Hamid of Cipla. He not only found a way to make affordable drugs, but to reach it to people, that too, taking on the government against the policies of industry, because they cared for humans and not for wealth. Incurring the wrath of companies across the globe and even Indian competitors fighting against the monopoly and profiteering, focused on single mission to safeguard the lives and livelihood of millions of patients. After HIV/AIDS, Cipla, under his leadership, has now taken the fight for the cancer drugs. The cost of close to ₹3 lakhs per patient per month has now become to less than ₹6,000 a patient. He says 95% of multinationals' profits are made in markets of Europe, US, and Australia. I don't worry about them. First, I want what is best for my country, and second, what is best for the developing countries. He is not only a Gandhian in vision, but also in his mission. He strongly believes in giving back to the scientific community, as exemplified by his institution of the Yusuf Hamid Center at Christ College, Cambridge, involvement with Royal Society for training in the SALTUS program for training of deprived school children and teachers, and Cipla's palliative care and training center for the patients beyond cure. The motto is care beyond cure. He's a great lover of sports and music. I'm not sure whether he has missed any of the Wimbledon matches in the Central Court or any of the Lord's cricket test matches. He's been regular there. He was awarded the Padma Bhushan, India's third highest civilian honor by the Government of India in 2005. He has also received CNN IBN Indian Award in 2012 and was chosen among the 25 greatest global living legends by NDTV. One of the prestigious honors bestowed on him is the honorary doctorate in science by Cambridge University in 2014 for his services to the society. He is the first ever recipient of the newly founded alumni medal by Cambridge University in 2016. It is in the history of 800 years, he's been the first awardee. But he weighs all these honors lightly, and his attention is focused on the huge challenges that lie ahead for India in health and now in education. So ladies and gentlemen, I now request on your behalf, Dr. Yusuf Hamid, to give the foundation to the lecture.
Okay. Dear Dr. Ganesh, Dr. Nattu, Professor Shashidhar, friends and students, when I was asked to be with you today, I thought that I would speak to you on healthcare and access to affordable medicines and about the documentary film that some of you saw yesterday. But I felt that prior to this, and in fact, seeing so many young students in the audience, I felt that I should give you some of my views on an important subject, namely the transition from academia, that is, from university or academia, to industry. Now, when I talk on a subject like this, which I've done many times in the past, I tend to start with a quotation from Swami Vivekananda, and this I'd like to repeat to you, and which was that wisdom lies not in the amount of knowledge acquired, but in the degree of its application. All of you here will have to consider seriously, I mean the youngsters, not the elders, seriously, the important transition which you, when you enter the mainstream of your life. If anything is important in life, it is the future. The past is gone, and the present exists only as a fleeting moment. Everything that you think and do from this moment onwards can only affect your future. It is in the future that you will be spending the rest of your productive life. And that is why the whole issue is very, very important regarding your transition. However, you must understand the growing complexities that face all of us. Increasing population, worldwide poverty, disease, crime, drugs, racial disparity, political and economic upheavals. It becomes extremely difficult to make rational decisions required for planning one's own future. However, you must understand that this needs to be done, and done objectively and updated at regular intervals. Among many issues, you have to embrace a few which are essential. The top of my list here is imagination. This is a quality that differentiates people, and in particular, it differentiates scientists. There's one quality which is far more important than imagination, and that is enthusiasm. The feeling that what one is pursuing in life is the one thing that really matters. And the errors that you'll make following your own enthusiasm on a subject or whatever are to be preferred to the indifference of wisdom. The next is vision. You must anticipate, you must try and predict what are the best options available for progress. And finally, you must know the meaning of the word success. Now, success, ultimately for a student, lies in your overall competence. One has to be proficient in many individual functions, but there has to be a balance and coordination between them. One cannot achieve success simply by doing one or two things exceedingly well. You must be jack of all trades and master of a few. There is an old academic joke that I would like to share with you. A philosopher is a person who knows less and less about more and more until he knows nothing about everything. A scientist is a person who knows more and more about less and less until he knows everything about nothing. So the object of this, and I'm glad that some of you laughed on that, is that you all in life should tread a middle path between that of a philosopher and that of a scientist. the very designation of a PhD means what? Not in chemistry or physics. You are ultimately going to be a doctor of philosophy. So you have to be philosophical in your approach to life. Also, it is important, even at this stage, that you are aware of how the outside world functions. And you should therefore follow the basic preconditions to succeed in the years ahead. This includes responsibility, commitment, involvement, innovation, strategic planning, long-term objectives, flexibility, a willingness to accept risk, and above all, an environment which is conducive to growth. We live in a very competitive world, and hence to gain an advantage, you have to identify and understand matters in totality, including scientific, management, and commercial concepts. When you enter industry later in your life, you have to search and apply new concepts, identify problems, create new products, processes, and services that are required, make the best use of the resources you have, operate in areas of expanding industrial opportunities. Apart from that, in life, remember something, and that is that you must always consider contributing to the community in which you live and to safeguard the environment in which you live. Now, industrialists on their part, who are already industrialists, have to identify their own potential, and they have to therefore ask questions pertaining to what is their business, their competition, their capability, and future trends in technology. They have to forecast obsolescence and also future opportunities. Objectives have to be clearly defined in industry, and plans have to be made to achieve them, particularly long-term plans. And of utmost importance are the opportunities available in newer products. And in an institute like this, you are always looking to create newer products. A new product means has different requirements for different markets. And to define a new product is important. So a new product may be new to the industry, it may be new for the company and the consumer, or even new to only one of these. A new product may be actually just a new application of an existing product to create a new market. Existing products can serve you as a starting point in planning newer products with incremental benefits. Now, to achieve your best results in the future, you have to create products which are currently non-existent. And this is where institutes like ICER have to play a major role. I would now like to change the subject, and I hope that so far I've made you aware of the difficult task that lies ahead of all of you, of most of you, in the area of transition to industry. I felt this many, many years ago when I joined industry in 1960. And it is important, therefore, that you are aware of the avenues, and ICER should point out the avenues that are open to you based on your individual skills. I would now like to talk to you on a subject that is closest to me, and that is healthcare. The world today stands divided between the rich and the poor, stands divided between the developed and developing countries, stands divided between global north with 600 million people and global south with over 3 billion people. Those countries who most desperately need medicines are those that can least afford them. Enabling access to good quality, affordable medicines, in my opinion, is a basic, fundamental human right. It is about preventing disease, fighting infections, easing suffering, and saving lives. One third of the world's population lacks even basic medicines. In Asia and in India and in Africa, this goes up to over 50%. The right to live should not be contingent on the ability to pay. And this is a thing that myself and my company, Cipla, have always looked at, that to live should not, none should be denied medication. And I think that is the topic that we have taken upon ourselves, our motto, that none should be denied medication. Lives should not be sacrificed at the altar of corporate profit and greed. It is unfortunate that today, worldwide, economic power is stronger than moral values, and this is something that should be an object lesson for our own government, that you have to look at the moral side before you look at the economic side of matters. In India, however, there appears to be a great deal of ignorance and a lack of understanding on the issues that are connected with intellectual property and monopoly. This is of particular importance in the area of medication and healthcare. At the time of our independence, India followed the British patent law of 1911. When I joined the pharma industry in 1960, I saw straight away that I could not manufacture any drugs because they were all, any good drug, because they were all covered in a patent. It was a monopoly existing from the 1911 patent. We were now in 1960, and we could not even then produce any essential, important new drug. It was therefore in the year 1961 that we formed IDMA, Indian Drug Manufacturers Association, and we have with us an ex-president of IDMA sitting in the audience here today, Mr. Mazumdar. And we fought from 1961 for 11 long years with our government and the bureaucracy to amend the then prevailing draconic patent laws. In essence, what we did in those 11 years, we fought against foreign domination, we fought against foreign monopoly, and we stood for universal, affordable access to essential medicines. It was our own indigenous pharma industry's freedom struggle to get healthcare independence. In September 1972, the Indian Patent Act 1970 was passed. This was essentially based on India's needs at that point in time and affected only three areas: health, food, and agriculture. In these three areas, what the Indian Patent Act said, that you cannot monopolize the end product. You can only patent a process to make the end product, and that process patent would be viable for 7 years. So what happened in 1972, and I think Dr. Gujjar here, who's from NCL at the time, is fully aware of the situation. What happened, it opened the floodgates for India, that we Indians could then look forward and manufacture whatever essential drugs we wanted to legally, transparently, and without any patents on the end product. For the first time in India's history, we were able to take charge of the healthcare needs of our own people, and we can proudly say that we did not let them down. Today, the Made in India label for medicines is accepted worldwide. It stands for trust, it stands for quality, it stands for credibility, reliability, and sustainability of production. Recently, I read with great pride that in the year 2015, calendar year, India's domestic turnover in healthcare and in medicines exceeded ₹100,000 crores. India today accounts for 20% in volume of all global pharma exports. India is the third largest producer of medicines in volume in the world and the 13th largest in terms of value. India accounts for 10% of global pharma production, having 60,000 generic brands in 60 therapeutic groups. India produces 500 different active ingredients, and branded generics account for 80% of our domestic market. The industry is growing at 13% annually, and the target is that we will reach a turnover of $100 billion by 2025. We are the second largest holder of registrations of active substances and formulations in the USA, and approximately 30% of all the medications consumed in the USA have their origin in our country. Many Indian companies, like Cipla, our own company, have gone beyond generics. They have entered into innovation with indigenous cutting-edge technology and have entered into many, many allied and newer areas such as biotech, nanotechnology, vaccines, devices, stem cell research, and also have now entered into the area of new chemical entities. However, regretfully for all of us, and particularly myself, life changed in the year 2005 when the Indian government dismantled and relegated the Indian Patent Act of 1970. And this was done, in my personal opinion, and I stand by it, by the short-sightedness of all concerned, both the government and the public and we people. And this short-sighted policy is essentially because monopoly arising out of having product patents for drugs can lead to non-availability of medication, can lead to high prices, etc. And this is something that we in India simply cannot afford. We have gone back to the patent system that was in India from the time of the British pre-1972. Now, the adverse effect of this will plague India and indirectly the world's healthcare scenario for decades to come. We all worked hard to make India the pharmacy capital of the world. And regretfully, we now risk the prospect of India becoming the mega hospital of the world. Healthcare in India has always been in a state of perpetual crisis. The disease profile in India is frightening. 80 million cardiac patients, over 110 million afflicted with mental illness, 60 million diabetics, 60 million asthmatics, 50 million hepatitis cases. One in three Indians suffers from what is called latent TB. These statistics that I'm telling you and I've presented to you is frightening. And our pharma industry should be above statistics. We have to concentrate on patients. We have to concentrate about saving countless of lives globally. we have a responsibility to the people, not only of this country, but the world. Because we today, so far, have been the pharmacy center of the world, supplying the world with medicine from India. I would therefore like to plead to all those concerned to have a pragmatic policy, drug policy, and a patent policy that serves the health needs not only of our nation, but those of the developing and the developed world. This existed immediately post 1972, which was the golden era for the Indian pharma industry. Now, what the government can do to avoid monopoly is to provide a favorable and pragmatic in-licensing policy for newer important patented drugs. We should strive to partner companies abroad who can then in-license us their products. India needs today a voluntary in-licensing system, or whenever necessary, if India requires a new drug, a workable compulsory licensing system. I'm a great believer that with a population that will be 1.6 billion by 2050, India should decide its own destiny. And India's destiny should not be decided in the corridors of power, be it Washington, London, or Paris. As a scientist, however, I believe that an inventor or an innovator of a new drug has to be suitably rewarded. There's no doubt about that. But that, if the drug is truly essential, it should not be sold under monopoly. It should be freely available, and the innovator or inventor should be given a suitable royalty on his work and his development. We all want a world where healthcare is provided to one and all, where every citizen can dream of a decent quality of life. And I think all of us here should commit ourselves to this concept and this philosophy and make this dream a reality. In this, what I've been saying for the last few minutes, we need the fullest cooperation and support, not only of our government, but all concerned, so that this Herculean task can be achieved. In conclusion, my friends, success is not a destination that one ever reaches. Success is the quality of the journey. The overall achievement of an industry or a company or even an individual cannot be judged by monetary gain, but by the capacity and capability to contribute towards the moral and social obligations to society. Your parents gave you life. And this is for the students here in ISA. I don't know how many are there in this room. But your parents gave you life. ISA is educating you. ISA is teaching you how to live. ISA is showing you how you can contribute to our nation's scientific progress and make India the envy of the world. Hopefully, all of you in due course will be valuable assets to our country in the years ahead. On that note, thank you very much.